Fair warning, there will be story spoilers ahead, as well as gameplay mechanics. Enjoy. Shadow of War is one of those games that did not get the respect it deserves. Yeah, in the beginning it had its loot boxes and stuff, it had a difficulty spike and some grindiness, but that was kind of the charm, and to people that love games, you can forgive a lot of that nonsense that was in there at first. But luckily for you, you're playing it now in 2019. The game is in its prime. Shadow of War runs in the same engine that the Batman Arkham games ran on, and that is an amazing thing because the combat from the Arkham series was second to none. So many games like this that I've played in the past, they've given you powers or access to gadgets and gizmos, and you always kind of felt like a chump. Be it Spider-Man, be it Infamous, be it Prototype, you have an amazing array of powers, but you feel like a chump using them because you don't feel powerful. Shadow of War makes you feel powerful as you grow with your character. You get an array of combat moves from executions, countering, shadow strikes. You feel like a ring wraith as you're going about this world, and that's what they were trying to go for. If you're playing Shadow of War now, then you are in for a treat because the combat options are so deep. It reminded me of playing Breath of the Wild for the first time. You had no idea what's possible, and you, the player, got to choose what to do and how you unlocked your moves. Even the newer, amazing God of War still limited you on your combat options, and that's why the replay value of that game isn't that high. One of the biggest strengths that Shadow of War has going for it is its high replay value. I can go back now, sit down, and the game's gonna be totally different. And that's where I wanna talk about things like the Nemesis system. The Nemesis system came about from Shadow of Mordor. This was so creative. If an orc killed you, he would remember what he specifically did to you and throw it in your face later. Or if you killed him and somehow he survived death, or he watched his friend die, he remembers that stuff and he would bring it up to you later. And that is an entire game in itself. Forget the story, honestly, at that point, I'll get there, but put the story aside, put the other things aside. You are creating your own narrative in this game because the orcs changed based on what you did. And from Shadow of Mordor to Shadow of War, they did something that's gonna make you wanna go back and play Shadow of Mordor before you play Shadow of War. If you had a nemesis from Shadow of Mordor, he came into Shadow of War. The first time I saw that, I don't remember what my nemesis was. It was probably like Splooge Smock the Strong or something. But he was in my Shadow of War game. And I'm like, this, I remember killing him. This son of a bitch is back. They truly doubled down with the nemesis system in Shadow of War. I've tried so many different things and I still don't know what's possible. Towards the end of the game, you get a power and the ability to shame an orc, which it lets you level the orc down, but you can also mess with his mind, and this is where the true genius of the nemesis system starts to shine. There was this one orc that I kept going out of my way to shame, and eventually his mind broke and he became deranged and he started to repeat this one phrase over and over again. He kept saying, "Where is it? Where is it?" I don't know what he was looking for. I assume he was looking for his mind that I stole from him. But this became a physical manifestation for this orc. I would follow him to different areas, going on my way to specifically not kill him just to see what would happen. Eventually, I followed this orc until a camp where I saw a barrel of grog. I decided to go to that barrel of grog and take my little poison and put it in there. Then I hid on a roof and kind of just waited. Another orc ambushed me while I was waiting, saying, "Ranger, you did something to my friend or something ridiculous." So I started fighting him. But in the distance, you always heard, "Where is it? Where is it?" And I'm in constant combat, just hearing, "Where is it? Where is it?" And also in this game, when an orc captain dies, it zooms into him and it shows you how he's died, be it by you, monster, or anything else. This orc walking around screaming, "Where is it?" You see the camera zoom into him as he buries his head in the poison grog. Buries his head in the poison grog, singing, "Where is it? Where is it?" as he dies, screaming, "Where is it?" as he's poisoning himself with the poison grog. This orc went all over creation until my actions killed him in a way that I'm no longer responsible for. And if you tell me that's not genius game mechanics, then I don't know what you're still doing here.
Don't know. Don't know.
Outside of the combat, there's other amazing things just about the orcs that will blow your mind. There seems to be an unlimited amount of dialogue options for these orcs. I challenge you to wait in a bush or hide on the side of a building and just listen to what they're gonna say. They're gonna say some weird things, man.
Bloody fool, you don't pet Caragor. You deserve to lose that hand.
You will be pleasantly surprised when you see an orc captain come back that you've killed and says he cheated death on it, but let's say you cut off his arm and leg when you were fighting him. He'll come back with like a little fork hand and like a robot leg, and his name will be different, and you're just kind of standing there like, how did you even survive? Now let's dive into some story components, because the story itself meshes with the gameplay and I think is one of the best things that have been done in years. Picking up right after the events of Shadow of Mordor, you and Celebrimbor forge a new ring of power so you stand a chance of fighting Sauron. But this also works as a gameplay piece as well too, with new ways to dominate orcs and new powers that you get for Talion. The game has a small tutorial phase in the beginning, but that's okay because there's a lot of stuff that you can do inside this game that you don't want to get lost in. They show you things for how to brand orcs, how to control their minds, and how they can do your bidding for you, but it also introduces you to how you're going to do one of the newest components of this game, and those are castle sieges. The first time you siege a fort, you are gonna feel like a little kid again. You have no idea the possibilities of what you can do, and all you know is your DIY army of orcs are standing right behind you, and the cinema ends with Talion saying charge. And this is such a cool piece because you go in there with the army that you created with siege weapons, and they have siege weapons, and there's a dragon flying and a growl running around, and you're just caught in the middle with your sword like, duh, I guess I'll run this way. And eventually, once you get inside and kill the captains, you open the doors like a badass, and sitting on the throne is the War Chief. The War Chief is a smug douche. The second you open the door, he has something smart to say, and all you are thinking is a million and one ways that you're gonna kill him. And once you've done that, the tutorial for the most part's over, but that's where the brilliance of the story kind of kicks in. You see, once you've taken your first fort, the orc that taught you how to do all this stuff betrays you. And that teaches you a key aspect of the game, that orcs still can't be trusted even if they're branded with your handprint. So why is that so important? It means that they've crafted an amazing story that works side by side with the game mechanics. And that's what I want to bring up right now. Celebrimbor tells Talion that it's time to fight Sauron, but Talion wants nothing to do with that. He wants to gain more power and rise up so he has a better army to take Sauron on. But Celebrimbor tells him, you're nothing without me. But Talion believes that Celebrimbor's nothing without him. And that is when it happens. Eltariel shows up and Celebrimbor decides that we're going to take the ring away from Talion and give it to her, and they'll fight Sauron together. But we all know that if Talion removes that ring, that he's gonna die. And watching this as a player, seeing your two characters become separated, it's not heartbreaking, but you instantly become mad at Celebrimbor. You kind of want him to lose, but you want Talion to just stand up, but he doesn't. Just as you think Talion's about to die, he reaches over and grabs another ring from the ring wraith that he just killed, and he puts it on himself. This saves Talion's life, but we all know that he's now cursed and he's gonna turn into one of the ring wraiths soon anyway. This story moment gives another gameplay shift and changes the powers that you've had this entire time. No longer do you have access to Celebrimbor's magic. You are now Talion as your own wraith, and it gives you a different set of powers. You can now raise the dead. So the orcs that you have that die, you can bring them back to life now. In game, you do that, the player. So if you have an amazing war chief or an orc captain that you like and he falls in combat, you can bring the orc back, but he's a zombie. He changes also too. No longer can the orc speak. They're more powerful, but they're weak to fire. And similar to Red Dead Redemption, when that had a big story moment towards the end, everyone knows what I'm talking about. It changed the game for you and you wanted to play differently. Now, when you're Talion with a new ring and you realize that you're almost a cursed ring wraith, you could bring things back from the dead, you will play different. Maybe you're no longer shaming orcs, you're just killing them and raising them for your undead army to do as you please. But it gives you, the player, a new decision and a new way of playing the game. That's another dynamic shift. So even towards the end, when you think this story's coming to a climax, they give you a new set of powers and almost refreshes the gameplay for yourself. So now the story kind of ends with Talion defeating the other ring wraiths as well too, and he goes on his journey knowing that he's about to turn into one of them. But that's when another key aspect of the game pops up and enhances its replay value, and those are the Shadow Wars.
It's sickeningly sweet the way you pine for this place, pink skin.
I remember when Shadow of War first came out, so many people were complaining about the Shadow Wars, and that's because the marketplace was still live and you had these loot boxes. So some of the less skilled players were getting wrecked by these other fortresses because you had to attack them, but in the next stage of the Shadow War, you also had to defend them. And if you lost the defense, you lost your progress. So if you weren't good at the game, you were kind of stuck for a little while. But you're playing the game now. And in 2018, Monolith changed it and removed the marketplace, and you can no longer buy loot boxes. So the other powerful orcs now just roam the land, and you can unlock them just by fighting them. This gave players a better opportunity to have more powerful orcs to make it a little bit easier for them in the Shadow Wars. And once you finally defeated the Shadow Wars, you gain access to the true ending. And the true ending is very satisfying. For once, we get to see a good end to a character arc, and it's an amazing moment, but it's also a little bit heartbreaking. Before we get into the DLC, I want to talk about my favorite component of this game, and that's going to be photo mode. More single player games need to have photo mode. This mode itself gave me an additional 200 hours of playtime, because while in combat or outside of combat, you could dynamically pause it and see the custom animations and kind of see what you're doing. So as that orc that's giving you a whole bunch of trouble, you know, you dodge him and you do an execution, you get to pause it at the moment the sword cleaves his head off, and you get to have that nice snapshot. And that might make me sound like a sadist, but I love taking 1,000 orc photos from a bunch of different angles. And if you're a role player like myself, in your head you're making these stories, you will 100% appreciate this photo mode. This photo mode is so robust that you can change things from character expressions to different color palettes, all the way up to different styles. You can make your photo look like a comic book. It's so cool. Now let's dive into the DLC. They gave us access to nearly a half dozen new orc tribes. These were new powerful orcs that gave another layer of challenge to the player and another thing for them to do in game that was persistent that they can take on at any time. And because it uses the nemesis system, different orcs can now spawn with as the new tribe. So you're not fighting the same orc over and over. You're gonna fight a new custom orc that you wouldn't even believe that has a new strength or something.
That's sure to get you in and out of trouble.
The first story-driven DLC they gave us was the Desolation of Mordor. And in that, you played as Baranor. And this gave you another dynamic gameplay shift. You see, Baranor has no Ring of Power. So what that means, if he dies, that chapter for your DLC is ended and you restart, but you restart with the skill and experience you've gained. So it made you play a little bit more cautious than how you would play as Talion. Talion, you could just be running and slashing and dominating orcs, but you can't dominate an orc to switch them over to your side. And if you die, that's the end for you. However, Baranor got access to his own set of skills. You see, he was using gadgets, and that's when the Arkham engine kind of really shows its face. He's now grappling and he's gliding. You kind of feel like Batman again, but with a sword. And they gave him custom animations, and I'm a huge animation guy, so I took full advantage of photo mode while inside there. And although the Desolation of Mordor wasn't that long, the cool part about these DLCs is that it gave you access to that level as Talion after you've beaten it. So more forts, more orcs, and a new area with custom animations. It was like adding a whole other piece of the game while you already had another piece of the game that you just bought. And then of course we had the second DLC chapter, which was called The Blade of Galadriel. And this one you play as Eltariel, and rather than use the Ring of Power to dominate the orcs because she refuses, she uses the Blessing of Galadriel to purify the orcs and use the light to kind of destroy them. So her powers are different than Talion's and different than Baranor's, because she's putting light grenade traps, she's shooting light balls of energy. So in this one, you kind of feel like a pseudo Saiyan shooting laser balls and stuff. And although this DLC might be short, the final battle that she gets access to is very cool, because you actually fight the corrupted Talion, and that is very cool just to see the main character from the other side of the fight. So I wanted to end with a tip for the Shadow War, because I know a lot of people still get stuck with that one. While going into it, equip the skill that lets you spawn a Grog, a bodyguard, as well as lets you do the Shadow Strike where it pulls the enemy towards you. When you finally make it to the throne room and you have to fight that super hard war chief that's been giving you trouble, what you're gonna do is shadow strike to the very top where you see the archers and kill them, dominate the other two to switch them over to your side, and then look down and shadow pull the war chief up to you, and it negates the rest of the enemies. And if that doesn't work, because for some reason that war chief is arrow proof, summon your giant grog with you and you two just beat the garbage out of him and bring your bodyguard. You will win every single fight. So in conclusion, when Shadow of War first came out, it was underrated and overlooked because it had one issue of the loot box nonsense. But now that it has been taken care of, we are left with a polished gem of the game that's very rewarding. And after you beat it and get all your achievements and you get your platinum trophy, you will still go back to this game and play it because you have no idea what the next orc is going to say to you.
My fate is my own.
Shadow of War is a game that demands respect. And if you haven't played it yet, I'm sorry that I spoiled a couple things for you, but I implore you to go out and play this game. You will not be disappointed. I also wanted to give a special shout out to a Redditor named Goblin Stories. He helped do a lot of research for this video and inspired me with a lot of different information as well too. So that being said, in the future, if any of you want to help out with the video, feel free to reach out just as he did. Thank you for stopping by and watching a video about Shadow of War. I know it's not a new game, but I wanted to give it the respect that it deserved. So please share this video out with your friends, encourage them to get this game, but thank you for watching. Make sure to subscribe and all those random YouTube things. I don't know, I'm really bad at doing outros, but I'll see you in the next one.